Amen. Let's see. Amen. It's good to finally hear the organ again. It's been a while. For those of you, thank you, Miss Nita. For those of you wondering what on earth was going on with that, it's been a long season of repair for our organ. Finally got the company to come and get it fixed, and we're happy to have that on board. We got an exciting day of worship and fellowship together. Let's all stand and worship our God this morning.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
It is good to see each and every one of you on a beautiful Sunday that God has given us to be able to come together. We hope that you have had a great week, and as always, it is a privilege for us to be able to worship together with you. If you are visiting with us, thank you so much for being here. You have greatly blessed us with your presence. If you have the time, there should be connect cards placed in each pew. We would love for you just to take one of those cards, just put your name, your phone number, and your email in those spaces so we can, as a staff, reach out to you, welcome you to First Baptist Church, and get to know you and see if there are ways that we can pray for you and serve you. And you can just leave those cards in your pew at the end of service today, and we'll collect those. But we're glad that you're here. There's a lot of good things that's going to be happening here today over the course of the week, and we're going to tell you about that in just a few minutes. But before we do, I don't think there's a better way to kick off a worship service than celebrating those who've come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And today, we have a special treat for you, as we not only have a couple of precious children who are here to be baptized, but there's also a special guest that we have here that's having the privilege of baptizing those children. And so at this time, I would like to turn it over to Mr. Kenneth Wells. You can come on down, brother. We are saving him just for the most right moment here. There he is right there. Brother Ken, I'll turn it over to you.
Here. I'm no longer a deacon, I'm a pastor. Not a whole lot different. I'm lying. It's worse than being chairman. But no, it's so good, and I appreciate Shandy offering me this opportunity. We have a couple of candidates today. They're very special to our family. These are our grandchildren. So, yeah. Aw. Come on, buddy.
Turn around. Stand up here. Turn around. Just like that. You there? Okay.
This is Michael Vance Benson. Call him Vance. Several months ago, in case you don't know, I'm the pastor at Shiloh here in town. I think it was on a Wednesday night. We were getting ready to have prayer time, and Henley came up to me and says, Vance wants to talk to you in your office. Okay, that's odd. So I go back and I go, what is it, buddy? And he said, I asked Jesus into my heart. I said, what does that mean? He says, well, that means I need Jesus to go to heaven because I'm a sinner. And I asked Jesus into my heart. So I said, well, you answered that really well. I said, so let's get baptized. He said, well, okay, let's do that. So Vance, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? And do you believe that one day, because of that he was crucified and he rose from the dead, that you'll be with him forever in heaven?
Yes, sir.
Lift your hands up. My little brother in Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Even gee whiz.
Gee, my daddy.
Okay. Hold on. This is Henley Hilton Benson. She got saved at home one night. She asked Christ into her heart. In fact, kind of the same thing. She told her mom and then their dad, and they came over to the house and they told her grandmother, then they got to me. And she shared her same experience, basically what Vance has said. So we're just so happy. So Henley, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? And do you believe because he was crucified, buried, and rose again on the third day that one day you'll spend eternity with him?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Because of your faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my little sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Everybody should be that excited when they get saved. Okay, thank you.
Amen. How awesome is that? Nothing more precious than to see children come to know Jesus as the Lord and Savior, and then for family to be able to baptize family. I think that is so precious. And again, as I said, we not only have some special things happening today, as we just saw, but we also have some special things coming up this week. At this time, I would like to ask Miss Sarah Gwynn if she would come forward again. Last week, we shared a little bit about Fall Festival with you, what that looks like. That's coming up this Wednesday, but we're going to go over some of those details again. So at this time, Miss Sarah, won't you tell us about what's happening Wednesday night?
Good morning, everyone. It's very hot. Okay, so I have a challenge for everyone. Who all has your cell phones here this morning? Raise your hand. Okay. I need you to take your phones, open up Facebook, go ahead, pull up the church's Facebook, and I need you to share the post about Fall Fest, and I need you to mark that you are going, because the more shares and the more that we have going, the more it boosts our Facebook and the more that people see it. So while you're sharing and while you're posting that, I'm going to go ahead and give you a few announcements. One. Bring people to Fall Fest. We have a ton going on. We have around 12 to 13, 14 booths going to be set up. We're going to have a ton of candy, a ton of prizes, all kind of things for all the kids to do, some for the adults as well. We'll have food and hot dogs. We'll have a picture booth set up in the gym so everybody can go and take fall pictures. So Tuesday, I'm going to need help. Again, y'all all love me so much, and I get to ask for help all the time, but y'all are very good about coming and helping when I need it. Tuesday, around 2:45, we're going to meet in the gym, and we're going to pack some bags not of candy, but of little bags that every kid will get that'll have all church information in it. It's going to have a map so that you don't miss anything when you are going around all the booths, making sure everybody gets everything they need. We are planning on packing around 500 bags with all church information and stuff in it, so I'm going to need your help. So 2:45 in the gym on Tuesday for anyone willing to come and help do that. Classes, y'all can begin setting up your booths around 10 o'clock, and then please have those done by 4:45 at the absolute latest on Wednesday. The guys and myself will be here 8:30, 9 o'clock. We'll go ahead and get tables and stuff pulled out for you. I'll be around for anything anyone needs. Anybody forget something, let me know. I'll round it up for you. 4 o'clock on Wednesday, if you were willing to come and help pack food bags. We're going to start food bags. Warren's going to be on the grill with the hot dogs. So we're going to need help packing the brown paper bags like we did last year so everybody can just grab and go. And again, Sunday school classes, if y'all need any help with your booths, just let me know.
All right. Thank you very much, Ms. Sarah. So again, be in prayer for this. It's going to be a great opportunity to reach out to our community, to let them know about Jesus, let them know about First Baptist Church. And we want you to come, not only just to come and to greet, but bring people, bring grandkids, bring your kids, invite families to come. We want this to be a great day. The weather, as of right now, looks to be like it's going to be a perfect evening. And we hope that, again, people flood this place this coming Wednesday night. We're going to have a time of fellowship where you can go around, welcome one another to our service. We have a lot of visitors here today, so we are so glad that you're here. We want to make you feel welcome. And also, during that time, if you have a child that would like to go to Children's Church, we have Miss Judy Britt here on the front. You can send your child, if they're ages pre-K through first grade, you can send them to her. She will escort them to Children's Church, and you can pick them up downstairs in our fellowship hall at the conclusion of the service today. So at this time, please stand, go around, shake each other's hands, hug necks, welcome each other to our service as our ushers come forward for our morning offering.
Well, amen and amen. Let's say a prayer over our morning offering this morning. God, we thank you so much for just who you are. God, as we're settling back in our seats, God, just to worship you, to focus on you. Lord, we thank you for the love that you've given one another here in this place. God, I pray that as we go about your business here, as we just fall at your feet and lay our lives before you, God, that, God, we thank you just for the picture of baptism this morning. God, that Henley and Vance could just come and say, yes, we want to be obedient. God, I pray that we approach the offering plate the same exact way. God, yes, we want to be obedient. God, we want to see your kingdom grow. We want to be your child this morning. So bless those things in Christ's name. Amen.
And times I feel still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fear. Yeah.
This morning, we're going to be hearing God's Word from a standpoint of this new thing in our society called cancel culture, and kind of how anger plays into that, as that's been kind of what the sub-point of the sermon series is. And the fact is, God's grace and God's mercy are completely contradictory to what we as a society are doing, how we're responding to each other. Grace, mercy, hope, love. Because His grace is greater than my sin this morning. That's a lot of grace. His grace is larger than your sin this morning. We're going to sing grace that will pardon and cleanse us within. That's something that I cannot do for myself this morning. That's only done through Jesus Christ. So we sing marvelous grace of our loving Lord as we receive it this morning. Sometimes I think we forget just how good God is to offer us that grace. We don't deserve that. We don't deserve that. You see, we were in a state of complete hopelessness until Jesus Christ came and He lived a perfect, sinless life. Sacrificed Himself on the cross to pay for, again, my sin through that grace, through that mercy. So we can claim that living hope in Jesus Christ, our Savior this morning. He is our living hope. Let's worship Him.
How great the King is that we spoke your name into sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave's no claim on me.
Then came the morning.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory.
God, we exalt you and we lift you high today. From a place of humility, God, from a place of unworthiness, God, that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. We sing hallelujah this morning. So help us to respond to your word as you deliver it to us. In Christ's name, I pray these things. Amen.
Amen. And you may be seated, church. Again, thank you for being here this morning, as always. Thank you, Brother Tracy, our praise team, our choir, for leading us in worship. And now as we get to the preaching of the word, I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Colossians chapter 2 this morning. Colossians chapter 2. As you're turning there, as we enter part 10 of this current series that I've called In My Feelings, it is a biblical look at faith and feelings. And as you can see, we are today where the key passage is for this series. Colossians chapter 2, looking at how our feelings are supposed to work alongside our faith. And then as we have looked at the topic of happiness for several weeks, we then turned our attention to anger. We have been looking at anger for several weeks. We began last week looking at how we resolve our anger. How do we move past our anger? And today we're going to take that into another discussion about anger, but in a way that we see commonly used today in the culture that we live in. As you're turning there, most of you have heard of the best-selling author J.K. Rowling. And if you have not heard of her, you have likely heard of her best-selling book series called Harry Potter. I know some of you have read those books. You've maybe watched the movies. You're a fan of those. That may not be the taste of some of you that are in here. This isn't a pro or against Harry Potter or J.K. Rowling or anything like that. But the first Harry Potter book, which was called Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, it was released in 1998. J.K. Rowling would go on to write 6 more books that would sell, listen to this, more than 500 million copies. That's a lot of books. As a matter of fact, if you took all of the Harry Potter books that have ever been sold and you placed them end to end, church, they would go around the equator more than 16 times. J.K. Rowling would become the first author to earn more than $1 billion. Miss Rowling was adored by her fans and by people all over the world until one day in 2020, whenever she said or tweeted the wrong thing. In the media push of transgender issues that were going on that year, that had been going on for years prior, that we see going on today, but in a very strong media push of transgender issues that year, J.K. Rowling took offense to a national media article that refused to use the term woman. Instead of using the word woman or women, the article used the phrase, and excuse me, but this is what was said, people who menstruate. Miss Rowling was very angry with this, and she spoke about why are we eliminating the word woman. She disagreed with that. She couldn't understand why we would get rid of this word. And at the end of her tweeting her disapproval, it led to a social media firestorm to cancel J.K. Rowling. A lot of people went online saying, do not buy any more of her books. Some people wanted her Twitter account to be canceled. Some people did not want her to receive any credit for writing her books. They literally said, don't even put her name on these books anymore. Makes a whole lot of sense, right? And due to the pressure, though, listen to this, due to the pressure that was placed upon the movie studio who made the Harry Potter films, when it came time for them to create a film, the 20th anniversary special of Harry Potter, J.K. Rowling was not even invited to be a part of the production. Church, cancel culture is the modern generation's way of handling their anger. It's the way that the modern generation, a lot of them, handle their problems. And what that is essentially is this, if you don't know what I'm talking about. If you don't agree with modern philosophies, then you don't have any rights. You do not get forgiveness if you say something that goes against those philosophies. You do not get a second chance, and you are canceled from public profile or opinion. Many celebrities, many actors, musicians, politicians, TV personalities, and athletes have seen their careers become greatly affected because of cancel culture. A few years ago, there was a senior playing college football who was going into the NFL draft, was going to be a first-round pick, but lost millions of dollars and places in the draft because of something that he tweeted when he was 13 years old. 13 years old. What he said was wrong, but it would have been more than 10 years almost to the moment he said it, and it cost him because of cancel culture. And you know, a question that I have regarding cancel culture is the same question that I asked last week to each and every one of us when it comes to resolving our anger. What does Jesus think about it? What does Jesus think about cancel culture? Or how would Jesus respond to a situation where the crowds called for someone to be canceled? Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to poke the bear a little bit this morning, okay? So please bear with me. Don't get all like just angry if I say something. We're going to talk about some things that are uncomfortable this morning because cancel culture is uncomfortable. And it's something that is very present in the world that we live in today. But how would Jesus respond to a situation where crowds of people during his day would call for someone to be canceled? How would he handle that? Well, like all other questions that we have about how Jesus would handle a particular topic or what would Jesus say regarding a particular topic, we turn to Scripture, to God's Word. So this morning, if you can and are able to stand with me to read a few passages in God's Word, please do so. We're going to read together from the book of Colossians chapter 2 this morning, starting in verse 4. I'm saying this so that no one will deceive you with arguments that sound reasonable. For I may be absent in body, but I'm with you in spirit, rejoicing to see how well ordered you are and the strength of your faith is in Christ. So then, just as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in Him, being rooted and built up in Christ Jesus, just as you were taught, and overflowing with gratitude. Be careful that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit, based on human tradition, based on the elements of the world, rather than Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for your word. And this morning we pray, God, for clarity of Scripture, that I would be able to communicate this clearly, and that, God, that you would give us ears and hearts to listen and to obey to your word this morning. And we say this in your heavenly name. Amen. You may be seated. Church, the Christian life, it's about growing. Just as a human being grows from a baby to an adult, Christians are supposed to grow in their faith. As a matter of fact, Paul says that we must become rooted in Jesus Christ so that we may grow. We should be taught by Jesus in His Word. We should be matured by Jesus through His Word and through His Spirit. And we are to become more and more like Jesus with every passing day. And the growth that we're supposed to have in Jesus Christ, it's not only an internal growth, but it's something that's external as well. Our growth should be seen. Our growth should be lived out. Our growth should be expressed. Please hear me. There is no excuse, church, for a Christian not to grow. There's no excuse. And as we start this morning, let's look at point number one. Believers must embrace the knowledge and growth that comes with being rooted in Christ. I want to say that one more time. Believers must embrace the knowledge and growth that comes with being rooted in Christ. If we go back and we read verse 6 of Colossians 2, he says, "So then, just as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in Him." Be rooted and built up in Jesus and be established in the faith, just as you were taught and overflowing with gratitude. If we were to throw out a theological term here, the process of growth that happens through the Holy Spirit in our lives after we are saved is called sanctification. That's the word here. And the more that I'm rooted in Jesus and the more that I'm growing in Christ, the more that I'm being sanctified. It's where I, Shandy, am becoming less like my sinful self, and I'm becoming more like the Savior who redeemed me. And our sanctification comes with many benefits. We not only see and understand in Jesus in ways that we couldn't before. That's a great benefit after you're saved. And when you become rooted in Christ and through the process of sanctification, you not only learn more about Jesus, but you also learn more about yourself and how He's changing you. We not only see Jesus in ways that we couldn't before, but we also begin to see things differently. We see other people differently. We see ourselves differently. As a matter of fact, church, through sanctification, we learn to love and forgive ourselves and love and forgive others when we embrace the sanctification that comes from following Jesus. We find the ability to forgive ourselves of previous mistakes. Through sanctification and our growing in Christ, we learn to love ourselves when maybe at one time in our life before we were saved, it was hard to love ourselves. But we also learn to love other people in different ways too, in ways that we couldn't do before we were saved. We find the ability to forgive others for maybe things that they have done to us in our previous or done previously. 2 Timothy chapter 2, it says in verse 21, those who cleanse themselves from the latter, talking about those who were saved, they will become instruments for special purposes, made holy, useful to the Master, useful to Jesus, and prepared to do any good work. Church, when you were saved, doors of opportunity for yourself to do big and great things for the kingdom of God were opened. And one of those doors is a ministry of reconciliation. And the ministry of reconciliation is where you are able to forgive others because you now have the Holy Spirit living inside of you that empowers you to be able to do so. But also through the ministry of reconciliation, you have the ability to love others, even those who are hard to love. In church, we all know there are some people who are hard to love. But because the Holy Spirit lives inside of us and empowers us, we are able to love them in return. Church, hear me. Sanctification makes things possible. But if you don't allow the Holy Spirit to work in your life, and if you don't put forth the effort to grow in your relationship with Jesus, you and I will not be able to handle the pressures of sin and the enemy when he comes after us. When you get into your feelings, and especially anger, when you get angry and you're dealing with anger, if you are not rooted in Christ and you're not letting the Holy Spirit work inside of you, you will not be able to handle your anger the way that Jesus intends for you to handle it. Going back to anger again here, let's look at this. Church, you will never resolve your anger if you harden your hearts toward others and deny grace from being shown to them. That's a mouthful. Let me say that one more time. You will never resolve your anger if you harden your heart towards others and deny grace from being shown to them. In order for you to overcome your anger, you have to be able to release what's inside. You've got to be able to get that poison out. And in order for you to be able to release that poison, to get that anger out of your life, you must be able to forgive. And in order for you to be able to forgive, you have to be able to be, or must be, rooted in Christ. And church, hear me. When it comes to the topic of cancel culture, there is nothing, nothing Christ-like about cancel culture. There is nothing Christ-like about cancel culture, which leads us into point number two. Number two, believers, those of you who are saved in Christ, believers must avoid falling into the demonic trap of cancel culture. When we go back and we read verse 8, notice what Paul says in verse 8. He says, be careful, church. Be careful that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit based on human tradition, based on the elements of the world rather than Christ Jesus. Social media can be a blessing. We were able to go and visit my family this weekend. Most of you know my family's going through a lot of issues with their health right now. My parents, who I'm talking about. And we were going to go spend some time with my mother this weekend before she starts chemotherapy next week. And we also wanted to see Dad. But because of the day and age we live in, children under the age of 12 are not allowed to go into the hospital where my father is. So my kids could not go in and see their papa. But through FaceTime and other technology, they were able to talk to him through that. It was a blessing for us. There are blessings with technology. There are blessings with social media. However, and oh my goodness, social media can be a curse too. It can be, church, a cesspool of negativity, of whining, of bitterness, of division, of foolishness and weakness. Church, please hear me. And again, this is where I said I'm poking the bear a little bit. Imagine being so agitated about something or someone that you feel like you've got to post about it. Or being so agitated by someone or so angry with someone, you feel like you want that person who posted something to be punished and to completely canceled. And some of you are like, man, Brother Shanny must have seen some of my Facebook posts. I honestly haven't. I'm just going to be honest with you, church. If you gripe all the time on social media, I've probably already unfollowed you anyway. But when we think about cancel culture is a real thing that this country faces today. And church, I am dead serious. I'm not kidding when I tell you that at its core, cancel culture is not only wrong, it is demonic. I'm not saying, and I want to be clear, I'm not saying that people shouldn't be punished for things that they've said or have privileges removed for things that they've said that were hateful or be punished for things that they've done. I'm not saying that at all. But the thing about cancel culture is this. Cancel culture wants more than that. It wants to take away every opportunity for forgiveness. It wants to take away every opportunity for recorrection, for betterment. It wants to take away every opportunity for reconciliation. Cancel culture wants to destroy. And this is why it's not Christ-like. Here's the first one. There is no grace in cancel culture. There's no grace. There's no forgiveness in it. When we want to completely eliminate someone to where they can't even make a life for themselves, we are no worse than the enemy. A lot of times what's happening today in this cancel culture thing, they not only want these people taken off of any platform, they want them fired from their jobs. They don't want them to ever be able to work again. They want them to lose everything that they have, every dollar they have in the bank account. They want them shunned from society. They want them cast away, almost like they would do lepers in the time of Jesus. They literally want them to be eliminated from any form of society. That's what cancel culture is. There's no grace in it. But look what Jesus said in the book of Luke, Luke 6, in verse 37. He says, "Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned." But notice this. He says, "Forgive, and you will be forgiven." Notice what Jesus says here. Jesus says, if you and I want to be forgiven for things that we've done wrong, we must also learn to be able to forgive as well. And in order for you to be able to forgive, you have to be able to love. There's nothing about love, church, in denying someone forgiveness. That's the opposite of what Jesus did for us. I have a picture here of a quote about grace that I love. It says, "Grace is the face that love wears when it meets imperfection." Love that quote. Grace is the face that love wears when it meets imperfection. None of us are perfect. We're all going to say things that we disagree with. We're going to offend each other from time to time. But church, in those moments, if we can't show grace, then we have missed a tremendous tenet of the gospel. But also, there's no mercy in cancel culture either. There's not only no forgiveness, but it also comes with abandonment. "You're finished," is what cancel culture says. But again, that's not what Jesus said. In the book of Luke, chapter 6, verse 36, that verse before the one we just read, he said, "Be merciful, just as your Father is also merciful." As children of God, you and I, we are called to show mercy. People will make mistakes. I have made mistakes. You have made mistakes. There will be people that we won't agree with, but Jesus says, show mercy to others. Cancel culture refuses to show mercy. It only wants to abandon others, and it only wants to show hate. But there's also no humility in cancel culture either. There's no humility in it. People who push cancel culture, they only want to point fingers at others. They never want to admit that they're wrong. They never want to have a discussion. They never want to have a debate. And they will go after anyone who does not share their point of view. Now, I don't know where you stand with Joe Rogan. I got a picture of Joe Rogan. This is what you need to know about Joe Rogan. He has the most listened to podcast in the entire world. More people listen to him than they listen to any other news outlet. This guy who has a podcast, it's on Spotify. Joe Rogan, during the COVID pandemic and whenever all of the medicines were being given, there were different types of medicine, all that. Joe Rogan, because he did not trust some of the medicines that were being pushed by Dr. Fauci and who, and again, this is not a who's right, who's wrong. This is just what was happening. Joe Rogan decided to use a different medicine, one that his doctor said, "I think this is going to work better than any others." He took it. He got better. He got over COVID. And then he gets on his podcast and he says that he had taken this medicine that was contrary to what other people like the World Health Organization, the CDC, and others were pushing. He said, I took this one, I got better. And from that, there was this huge firestorm of people wanting to cancel Joe Rogan. Now again, this has nothing to do with whether he was right or wrong. This is the cancel culture movement that went after him. People were saying, boycott Joe Rogan. They were calling on Spotify, saying, Spotify, you better fire Joe Rogan. Take his podcast off of your system. Even Neil Young demanded that Spotify not play any more of his music until they removed Joe Rogan. Church, all of this over a medicine that he used to treat his symptoms. Now, in the end, Spotify did not fire Joe Rogan, and Neil Young realized that apparently nobody was listening to his music anyway. He probably should have remembered the Lynyrd Skynyrd song, you know, Sweet Home Alabama. Southern man don't need him around anyhow, right? He asked to have his music put back on Spotify. You see, church, a Christian, though, going back to what happened to Joe Rogan, and cancel culture, what it is, a Christian that refuses to admit wrong and only wants to point their fingers at others has greatly missed the mark. Church, we are called to be humble. We are called as children of God to be the standard of humility. But humility is not found in cancel culture. And I'm sorry if you're a Neil Young fan, if I hurt your feelings just a few minutes ago. But there's no humility in it. But also, there's no growth in cancel culture either. There's no growth in it. With cancel culture, if a person does something wrong, they're out, they're gone, they're finished. There's no going back. They are banned. Their platforms are taken away. Their books are taken off the shelves. They never get to redeem themselves. And church, hear me, that's not Christ-like either. Church, what if Jesus said no to the cross? What if Jesus said no? They're not worth dying for because of their sins. What if Jesus said that about us? What if Jesus said no to coming to this earth? What if Jesus said no to Zacchaeus, who had taken more from the people through his tax collections? What if Jesus said, no, Zacchaeus, you're canceled. I'm not going to your house today. What if Jesus said no to the thief on the cross that said, Jesus, when you enter into your kingdom, will you remember me? What if Jesus said, no, you're canceled because of what you have done? What if Jesus said to each and every one of us because of our sin and wickedness, nope, you are not worth grace. Church, hear me. Jesus did not come to cancel us. Jesus came to redeem us. He came to set us free. And as sons and daughters of the Lord Jesus Christ, you and I, we are called to be bearers of His image through our love, our mercy, our grace, and our service. Which leads me to the last one, number three. Believers, we must learn to live faithfully in the redemptive work that comes from Jesus Christ. Believers must live faithfully in the freedom that comes from the redemptive work of Christ. Look with me in verse 9, Colossians 2. It said, for the entire fullness of God's nature dwells bodily in Christ, and you have been filled by Him who is the head over every ruler and authority. You were also circumcised in Him with a circumcision not done with hands, talking about salvation here, by putting off the body of flesh in the circumcision of Christ, when you were buried with Him, and in baptism, in which you were also raised with Him through faith in the working of God who raised Him from the dead. Man, I love these two verses we're about to read here. Verse 13. And when you were dead in trespasses, He made you alive with Him and forgave you of all of your trespasses. He erased the certificate of debt. He erased it with its obligations, a certificate of debt that was against us and was opposed to us, and He has taken it away by nailing it to the cross. That's what Jesus did with our sin. And we must live faithfully in the freedom that comes from the redemptive work of Christ. Church, when you were saved, Jesus did cancel something, but it wasn't you. It was your sin. It was your condemnation. It was your penalty for your sins that Jesus canceled. Through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, you and I were made alive. Grace and mercy was given to you, and new life poured through your body through the Holy Spirit. No, friends, Jesus is not about canceling others. Jesus is about setting other people free. And you and I must live faithfully in the freedom that comes from His redemptive work for us. Amen? Amen. But as we close this morning, let me share a couple more things to help us understand about grace, about cancel culture, and how we can live faithfully in this freedom. Understand this about grace. Showing grace does not mean that you allow evil to persist. She said, but Shandy, there are some things that need to be canceled and done away with. Abortion, one of those. I agree with that. Shandy, wickedness needs to be canceled and done away with. I agree with that. But listen, just because we are told not to judge, because a lot of people say, well, the Bible says don't judge. Just because we're told not to judge, that does not mean we turn the blind eye to sin. It means that we stand boldly against sin. It means that we draw a line and we say that as children of God, we will not condone evil and wickedness. Ephesians chapter 5, it says in verse 11, don't participate in the fruitless works of darkness, but instead expose them. Expose sin. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 20 says, we are to rebuke sin. Rebuke sin. We point out sin through the lenses of the gospel, but we don't stand there with our pointed fingers at a world that needs to hear the gospel and we say to them, you're done, you're going to hell, turn or burn. No. We say no to sin, but we pursue the sinner because the gospel compels us to pursue the sinner. We don't block them from the doors of God's house. We don't cancel them from ever receiving grace or mercy because like them, you and I were once dead in our trespasses and sin as well. And the same blood that was shed for us on the cross of Calvary was also shed for them too. So, showing grace doesn't mean that we allow evil to persist. But this is what showing grace does mean. Showing grace means that we recognize the power of the cross and we recognize Christ's ability to bring new life into what sin has destroyed. Church, we are free because Jesus has set us free. We recognize that you and I, we were dead in our sins before Jesus, but through Jesus, we have also been made new. And there is no cancellation of us because we have been shown grace and mercy. And church, and with our freedom comes the ability to shine light into a dark world, a world that wants to cancel each other and those who don't share in their ideologies. But we as the church, we don't back down. We don't hide when they point the finger at us. We stand boldly on the Word of God. And even though they may come after us, we still pursue them. Not with condemnation or cancellation, but with the hope of the gospel. We pursue them with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We show grace. We show mercy. We show Jesus. Brother Tracy, as you come to close us out this morning, I want to ask all of you to stand today. As we stand, as we get ready to have a song of invitation, maybe there's somebody here today and you need to be shown grace and mercy. Maybe you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Today, you can approach the throne of grace. You can come before Jesus Christ. And it doesn't matter what you've done, Jesus, there's more grace in Him than there is sin in you. So maybe today you need to just surrender your life to Jesus. Maybe today you come and you've just been holding on to anger. Or maybe you have been angry towards someone else and you need to seek their forgiveness. Or you need to grant forgiveness. And you've just wanted to cancel them from your life. Maybe today you need to come and just pray that Jesus would remove a heart of stone and that He would give you the ability to be able to share grace and mercy with someone who has hurt you or offended you. Maybe today you're here and you have a need in your life. You need Jesus to touch your health. You need Jesus to step into your marriage and help your marriage. Maybe today you need Jesus to help your outlook, maybe to help you overcome your anxiety, to overcome your stress, maybe to help you overcome an obstacle in your life. Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe it's something else. Church, hear me. Jesus is still in the miracle business. Jesus wants to work in your life. You just have to approach Him and say, Jesus, here I am. Give Him your need and let Him work. Maybe you need to come forward to believer's baptism. Maybe you want to join the church. Whatever it is, you have this opportunity now as we also have a time to worship. Heavenly Father, we give you this time. God, whatever we need to do, may we do it now. Any decision that we need to make, may we make it now. And God, we thank you for being there for us. And while we were yet sinners, you still died for us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for being God. And we say this in your heavenly name. Amen. As we sing.
Grace that taught my heart to be.
Church, if you would, I want to ask you just to be seated for just a couple of minutes. Going to have a few announcements before we let you go, and we're going to do that very soon. But at this time, I would like to bring the Pike family up here, if you would. I tell you what, love this family. Many of you know Abby through our Learning Center, and a great blessing that she is to all of those kids in the Learning Center. And then also John, who I've had the privilege of getting to know for the last few weeks and months, and love their heart for the Lord and love their family. They have two precious children, Millie and Renly, and so blessed by them as well. And they are here today, and they want to unite with First Baptist Church to become part of this faith family here. If you would welcome them into our faith family, would you give me a big amen and a round of applause? Amen. Amen. Well, we are so excited for you, so thankful that you're here, and we look forward to just seeing how God's going to use you and just walking side by side with us and reaching this community for Christ and what God's going to do through their family as well. At the end of our service today, we'd love for you to just to greet them, if that would be okay, and welcome them, and you can go sit by Miss Terry here, and I know that that family is very precious to Miss Terry as well. And so we have a couple other closing announcements that we're going to make. But before we do those announcements, Brother Tracy, we need to handle a quick matter of business, as our church entered into a business meeting Wednesday night to talk about our 2023 church budget. And discussion was already done regarding the church budget, and today we are going to approve that with a vote of affirmation. And so if you are a member of First Baptist Church, as we continue this motion, which is to approve the First Baptist Church of Scottsboro budget for 2023, that church budget, would you please raise your hand in approval? All in favor? Are there any that oppose? Raise your hand as well. All right. Our 5:30 to 8 o'clock. You heard Miss Sarah talk about the booths. If you're putting together
amen. All right, I have one quick announcement. So we really, really appreciate Brother Shandy. And just all that he does for our church, how he serves us so faithfully in bringing God's word. And so next Sunday, this is all in your bulletin if you have your bulletin, but I want to make sure that we all know what's going on here. Next Sunday is Pastor Appreciation Sunday, not Staff Appreciation. We're going to love on just Brother Sandy, okay, next Sunday. That is October 30th, and very much I know he would appreciate, as we all do, just letters of thanks, gift cards, monetary gifts. You just love on your pastor the way that you know that God has called us to. He does so, so very much behind the scenes that nobody even knows about, that is just an awesome work of the Lord. And so that also is going to be paired with soup, sandwiches, and desserts. Again, that's in your bulletin as well. So if you join us after church next Sunday in the gym for soup, sandwiches, desserts, and love on our amazing, amazing pastor that God's blessed us with. I don't have that answer for you. I'm the messenger. We do? Okay. So bring the soup, sandwiches, and desserts. Otherwise, we're going to be really hungry. But fair enough. Well, let's all pray as we close. God, thank you for the day that we've had. God, that we can come and we can be very focused together. God, that we can laugh and smile together. God, I pray as we come together as a church and just love on our pastor and his family next Sunday, God, that we would bless them like they bless us. And God, I pray that in this culture that we live in, we be the light in the darkness. We be Jesus to someone this week when they say, no, we're shutting this down. We say, no, we're going to love through. So, God, I pray that we are exactly that in your kingdom. Help us to serve you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.